stand to your feet. Stand to your feet all over the building. Lift your voices and lift your hands for your glory.
Your glory.
I will do
anything.
Come on, lift your voice.
Just to see you. To behold you as my King. For your glory.
Father, for your glory, we will do anything. We want your presence more than anything. We thank you, Lord, that your presence is in this house, that the anointing is strong. Thank you for the people of God that have come today to learn more about you and to give more to you. I praise you, Lord, for the opportunity to be able to serve your people in word. My prayer is, God, that our hearts would be open to receive a revelation that would ultimately change our lives, make us less like ourselves, and make us more like you. We give you praise and we give you glory. We believe it to be done. I want you to do me a favor. I want you to grab somebody's hand. I really sense that we need to do this. And just for a second, the Bible says where two or three of us are gathered together there, he will be in the midst. I believe that there's some people in the building that you're going through some difficulties. You're going through some storms. And the reason I've asked you to grab somebody's hand is to let you know that you're not going through it by yourself. And so God has sent somebody into your life, a brother or a sister, to stand with you while you're going through your storms. I want you to look to somebody to the left or to the right and tell them you may be in a storm, but the storm's not going to get in you. Amen. Look to somebody or to the left or to the right and say, neighbor, the devil might have knocked you down, but he did knock you out. Now I want you to lift those hands in victory and let the devil know that after all we've been through, we still got joy. Now let's seal it with a praise if you don't mind. Hey, Jesse, give me some highs. Come on, let's seal it with a praise. Give me some highs, Jesse. Hallelujah. The Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run sin. And we'll say, how many of you glad that you're saved today, that you're going to heaven if you die? I'm so grateful today that I'm saved and I'm going to heaven when I die. You know, I've been through some difficult times, and many of you have been praying for me. I've been feeling real bad in the last month, but God is a healer. My body is strong today. Amen. My body is strong. And it wasn't the doctors, wasn't the nurses. I thank God for doctors. I thank God for nurses. Some of my best friends are in the medical field. But I know one thing. Today, I know that I'm standing here stronger than I was last week because of the saints praying for me. And I want to thank God that you pray for me. Some people think that their pastor is only supposed to pray for them. But aren't you glad that you're wise enough to know that you're not just supposed to be prayed for by your pastor, but you're supposed to pray for your pastor? And I'm just very elated that many of you have spent time laying before the Lord. I hear that many of you have been fasting and not eating for me and my family. And I'm very, very grateful for that. And I love you. I want you to know I love you. That comes from me, comes from Lady Arnold. I just thank God for you. I've got a wonderful friend with me that has come with me. I just don't like to tell y'all some stuff because I don't want to sound arrogant and stuff, but there's a very prestigious organization in this city called Leadership Knoxville, and it's one of the premier leadership training programs and organizations that this city has. And you gotta pledge and stuff to get in, and you gotta carry a brick, get wood, not walk on grass and stuff to get in. I was nominated by one of the brothers that were connected to our ministry, and they let your little old pastor in that bougie group of people. So one of the guys that I've just fallen in love with, boy, you got to be careful about saying that these days. One of the guys that I just really love, is Rob Petroni. He's with us today. Want to worship. Would you just wave at us, man? Just a great man of God, and he's with us here today. Whole class gonna come. The whole class is gonna come, but my man with me, man, and I just wanted to hang out with him and thank God for great friends. Amen. Great friends. And so would y'all give God a great big thank you, Jesus, for all of our visitors today. You don't have to come here. You didn't have to come here. I told Rob, I said, now black church a little different. He showed up at 12. I said, yeah, you gonna think I ain't got nobody. I said, just look around. About 30 minutes later, look around. You won't be able to get a seat. Amen. So that's just how we do, player. Amen. That's how we roll. Amen. We still on Ghana time. Amen. As I mentioned Ghana, I will be going to Ghana in a few weeks, and I will be going to Ghana doing some missions there. I'm very grateful that you all allow me to go and do kingdom business, not just here in this city. Let's just get them some seats somehow, some way. And I just thank God that you allow me to travel across the city, travel across the country, and travel across the world to be able to do great godly things and take the Open Coming Believer Spirit with us. I want to thank you so much for putting up a well in Nigeria. People are drinking clean water. Amen. We're about to do some more work in Ghana. And then we're going to do a Haiti trip. And we're going to open it up for those of who just want to go to Haiti with us. Amen. Amen. We're going to open that up. It's not just going to be leadership only. We're going to let y'all go and get your hands dirty. You're just doing great things. Overcoming Believers Church, you're doing great things all over this city, all over this city. Stuff you don't even know about. You're taking care of teachers you don't even know about. You're feeding Austin East every home game you don't even know about. That's why they're winning, because we feeding them. Praise the Lord. Amen. We put the anointing all in that chicken. Amen. We're feeding them, and we're just doing great things all over the nation, and I thank God for all of you. It can't happen unless you're praying, unless you're giving money. So thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you so much. I want you to, one more time, thank God for yourselves. We did Compassion Sunday on last Sunday, and you all sponsored 40 kids in here and 20 kids in the Mobix. You're taking care of children all over the world, taking them out of poverty and putting them into places of prosperity. Thank God for all of you. Is that it, Minister Watkins EP? Is I'm good? And you can still sponsor a child today. So we'll have a table set out. For $38 a month, you can take a baby that whose both parents have died of HIV and they're living in the slums, eating dirt and roadkill. You can pull them out of those slums. Not only will that $38 a month give them a place to stay, but it will house them, clothe them, feed them, and send them to college. Send them to college. So those of you that have sponsored children in Ghana, my wife picked up a little girl in Ghana. I'm going to get to visit her in a few weeks. And so we're really, really excited about it. All right? And then if any of you got Haiti, if any of you picked children up from Haiti, when we go to the country of Haiti, they will bring those children to you. And so you can meet those babies. Okay? All right. Well, God bless you. One more time, give God praise for all that he's done. God bless you. I'm not going to keep you long. I'm using the wisdom of the Holy Spirit, my wife, and the doctors, and I'm not going to teach long. I can't. So when I start running out of energy and stuff, I'm just going to stop, all right? I'm going to be wise. I want you to turn your Bibles to 1 Samuel, the 28th chapter. I want to look at it out of the Message Bible. 1 Samuel, the 28th chapter out of the Message Bible. In lieu of October, the month of October, what does the month of October represent? Huh? Harvest, what else? What else? When you think about October, what you think about? Y'all just trying to be spiritual. Somebody like breast cancer awareness. The harvest, the new moon. Feast of Atonement. Oh, Halloween, amen. Halloween. And it is also, y'all, I'm all off today, but I need all of my clergy to wave at me. If you're connected to Fivefold Ministry in any way, wave at me, wave at me, wave at me. Y'all look around. It is Clergy Appreciation Day. We got to learn how to preach a month. We got to learn how to appreciate preachers. Amen. Amen. But October, if from a carnal perspective, from a worldly perspective, really illustrates a holiday called Halloween. Halloween. Hallowed be thy name. Worship Holly, Holy Ween. And it is a pagan holiday. It is a pagan holiday that does not necessarily exalt Christ,
but it exalts spirits, evil spirits. And sometimes we can get pulled into stuff and not know what we're getting pulled into. It's not our fault. It's just ignorance. We're not aware. And so I want us to, this month, I'm going to be dealing with a series called No More Nightmares. No More Nightmares. So by the time I get finished preaching these next 3 weeks, every curse that is over your life is going to be broken. Every financial curse is going to be broken. Every generational curse over your family is going to be broken. As a matter of fact, bump somebody and tell them the curse is broken. All right, so I'm going to be teaching about fear and how we're going to snatch our faith back and give the fear that the enemy has placed in our lives back to him. 1 Samuel, the 28th chapter, verse 3. Samuel was now dead. All of Israel mourned his death and buried him in Ramah, his hometown. Saul had long since cleansed out all of those who held seances with the devil. With the dead. The Philistines had mustered their troops and camped out in Shunan. And Saul had assembled all Israel and camped to Gilboa. But when Saul saw that the Philistine troops, when he saw them, he shook in his boots, scared to death. Verse 6 says, Saul prayed to God, but God didn't answer him. Neither by dream, nor by sign, or by prophet, God wouldn't talk to the man. So Saul ordered his officials, find me someone who can call up spirits so I may go and seek counsel from those spirits. His servant says, there's a witch in Endor. Saul disguised himself by putting on different clothes. Then, taking two men with him, he went undercover of night to the woman and said, I want you to consult a ghost for me. Call up the person I named. The woman said, just hold on now. You know what Saul did, how he swept the country clean of mediums. Why are you trying to trap me and get me killed? Saul swore solemnly, as God lives, you won't get in trouble for this. The woman said, so whom do you want me to bring up? Samuel, bring me Samuel. That's his prophet. And when the woman saw Samuel, she cried out loudly and said to Saul, why did you lie to me? You're Saul. The king told her, you have nothing to fear, but what do you see? I see a spirit sending from the underground. And what does he look like? Saul asked. He looks like an old man ascending, robed like a priest. And Saul knew it was Samuel. He fell down, face to the ground, and worshiped. And Samuel said to Saul, why have you disturbed me by calling me up? Because I'm in deep trouble, Saul said. The Philistines are making war against me, and God deserted me. He doesn't answer me anymore, either by prophet or by dream. And so I'm calling on you to tell me what to do. Why ask me, said Samuel. God has turned away from you and is now on the other side of your neighbors. God has done exactly what he told you through me. Rip the kingdom right out of your hands and has given it to your neighbors. It's because you did not obey God, refused to carry out his seething judgment on Amalek, that God does to you what he is doing today. Listen to this. Worse yet, God is turning Israel along with you over to the Philistines. Tomorrow, you and your sons will be with me. And yes, indeed, God has given Israel's army up to the Philistines. Saul dropped to the ground, fell like a tree, terrified by Samuel's words. I want you to tell your neighbor, leave them witches alone. Yeah. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I know that was Ebonics. It just sounded better than leave those witches alone. Leave them witches. Witches alone. So as we begin to flow into this October celebration, I was dropping my son off to school. Timberland, he goes to Cedar Bluff Elementary, and I was pulling into the driveway. Don't worry about it. We're going to leave them witches alone. That's just some witches. You can tell the people ain't been living right, they're scared. We were going through the driveway to drop him off, y'all, and I looked at the Mylar, the LED screen Mylar that is outside, and it gave all of these announcements, but in bright orange, flashing, that everyone might identify it. It said, Happy Halloween. I didn't have a real problem with that, but it reminded me of last Christmas, as the school year was about to be over, that on that very same Mylar, it did not say Merry Christmas, but it said Happy Holidays. It is interesting to me that we have no problem celebrating the devil's holiday, but when it comes to celebrating the birth of the soon coming king, then we have to be politically correct. Now, we cannot help or manage or even perhaps not immediately legislate or change legislation in regards to what government has done in regards to our Christian holidays. However, we can avoid dabbling with the demonic and being pulled into places of principalities. We've got to be extremely careful about messing with demonic influences, because once you wake them up, they don't allow you to go easily. Now, most people want us to believe that witches and warlocks and devils and demons are literally fictional characters that only take place on horror movies such as Friday the 13th, The Nightmare on Elm Street, or shows like that. But I want you to understand that just as God is real, angelic hosts are real, heaven is real, so also is demonic influences and demonic spirits that are loosed in the earth. They are also real. And so one of the strategies of the enemy is to try to get us to believe that the occult, the demonic, the devils that we read about in the Bible are fictional, and no, they are not real. But how many of you know that the devil and his demons are real? Amen. And so you cannot fight what you refuse to believe in. But here's the good part. I don't want you to be afraid. I don't want you to be fearful, because the Bible says that upon this rock shall I build my church, and the very gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Just because the enemy does have a strategic plan to try to tear us down and to take us out and to destroy the kingdom of light, God has put us inside of him. And the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous can run in and be safe. But just because we have power and authority to tread over scorpions and serpents, and we can drink poisonous things and by no means anything shall hurt us, we'll be healed from whatever the enemy tries to place on our life, it does not mean that we need to flirt with the things of this world. In this particular passage, it is a powerful story, because Saul was walking with a man who was a prophet, and his name was Samuel. First time you really see Samuel operating in his anointing is in 2 Samuel, early 2 Samuel, where the Bible says that he was a student, a pupil of a priest called Eli. And the Bible says that God began to call Samuel. Remember, he was sleeping next to the Ark of the Covenant, and God woke him up and would not allow him to rest until he started walking in his calling. Some of y'all are in that place right now. You're trying to figure out why you don't have any peace in your life. Trying to figure out why you sleep 8 hours, and then when you wake up, it feels like you hadn't even closed your eyes. It feels like every demonic spirit that the enemy has to offer has attacked your life, and you cannot get any peace or solace. It is not that the devil is trying to destroy your destiny. It is because God is trying to get your attention. And I decree and declare that you will have no peace until you start walking in the purpose and the destiny which God called you. Some of you know good and well he's called you to ministry. He's called you to some form of proclamation of the gospel. He's called you to serve him in some way. But because you have your own separate agenda trying to make some money, get paid, and get rich or die trying, God says, I refuse, no matter how much money you make, to give you a good night's rest until you start walking in the calling in which God has set up in your life. And one of the things I learned about God is you might be able to box with him, but you will never win. He will never win. You may be able to run from him, but I promise you, you'll get tired before he does. And so God is always seeking to save us and to pull us into our calling, because that's the only place you can get some peace. And Samuel was assigned to Saul, the king, because every king had a prophet so that they could hear from God in a way that no one could ever hear from God, that they might strategically be able to win battles. And Saul would get his word from Samuel. The problem is, the Bible says that Samuel died. The anointing that was on Samuel's life in order to give him revelation and understanding for Saul, he died. And the Bible says that when he died, the Philistines came up against Saul, and they were trying to produce a strategy to destroy Israel and Saul and to rip the kingdom of God out of their hands. And the Bible says that Saul, when he saw the Philistines, he was terrified. The Greek word there, the Hebrew word there, is terror. It's where we get the word terrorism or terrorist from. The way that the enemy uses his strategic plans against the body of Christ is to show us something that is bigger than us and produce terror in our lives. You know what a terrorist does? He does everything he can to immobilize you, to keep you from moving into what God wants you to have. During 9/11, there was a plane that went into buildings. These planes went into buildings and it shut the airports down all over the country and all over the world. Not one airplane could go from one place to its destiny because there was this terroristic group that had come and immobilized the whole world. That's what the enemy is trying to do to you. That's why you're struggling with fear. That's why the enemy is placing huge stuff in front of you, trying to immobilize you to keep you from getting to where God wants you to be. But if you can overcome your terror, God will expand your territory. If you can get over the thing that is bigger than you, God will give something to you that's bigger than you. Can I get a witness up in here today? I don't have a lot of strength, but I feel somebody about to kick me in my back, push me into the presence of God. You see, the enemy always tries to show you how big he is. That's what David was saying in Psalms 23. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Now, when you heard me say that, you know what the word that echoed out of the corridors of my mouth into your ears? You know what you received? The word death. But you know what I heard? The word shadow. It is not death. It's just the shadow of death. And if there's a shadow, there's got to be some light somewhere around. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Can I preach to you and tell you that shadows always make things look bigger than they actually are? I'm not saying that your problem is bigger than you, but I am saying that your God is bigger than your problem. I feel like preaching today. He tries to terrorize them. That's why the Bible teaches us scriptures that we need to receive, like, set yourself, be still, for the battle is not yours, but it is the Lord's. Well, that's why the Bible teaches us scriptures like, be of good courage, fear not, and be of good courage. That's why the Bible says things like this in 1 John, the 4th chapter. He says, perfect love cast out all fear. That's why the Bible says something like this in 2 Timothy. The Bible says, for God has not given you a spirit of fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind. I decree it over your life tonight. You're going to sleep good tonight. No more nightmares in your life. You're not going to be afraid whether your children are going to end up dead or not. You're not going to be afraid whether you can pay your bills or not. You're not going to be afraid whether your boss is going to fire you or not. The devil is a liar. If God be for you, hey, he's more than the world against you. Everybody shout as loud as you can. No more nightmares.
I'm not going to let bills scare me. He is Jehovah Jireh, the Lord God, my provider. I'm not going to allow a sickness or a diagnosis from my doctor scare me. The devil is a liar. He is Jehovah Rapha. He's the Lord God, my healer. I'm not going to let no knucklehead stalk me on Facebook and tell me he going to do something to me or spread my business all over the internet. The devil is a liar. He is Jehovah Nissi, the Lord God that fights my battle. Let me say it this way. No weapon formed against me is going to be able to prosper, and every tongue that rises up against me in judgment is already. Oh, I feel like I'm getting my strength back in here. I feel like I'm getting my strength back. What the devil doesn't understand is, although, hear this, brothers and sisters, he has strategies against your life, although he has an assignment to take you out, God has an assignment to take you in. Although the enemy has an assignment to put you down, God has an assignment to lift you up. Although he has an assignment to kill you and to destroy you and to steal from you, God says you are blessed in the city and blessed in the field. You're blessed in your lying down. You're blessed in your gathering. Let me say it this way. Can't nobody curse what God has already blessed. Can't no cat walk across my path and destroy me. You can't bury no bones in my backyard. You can throw salt over your shoulder all you want. Devil, you just gonna get high blood pressure because God's got his hand on me. Anybody believe that? Somebody shout, no weapon, no weapon, no weapon, no weapon. Can I prophesy to you and tell you, even the weapon you form against yourself ain't gonna work. You ain't even gonna be able to destroy your destiny and purpose, because this ain't about you, it's about God. He saw them Philistines and he got afraid. Terror. Terror. Phobos in the Greek, phobos, phobia. He got afraid and he began to allow his fear to destroy his faith. And you know what he did? He went to God and prayed. Problem is, God didn't answer. Have you ever gone to God and prayed? Oh, y'all spiritualized. And God didn't answer. I know y'all, you and God, you know, y'all went to school together. And every time God, you know, you send God an email, he reply right back. But sometimes I feel like me and God ain't on speaking terms. Sometimes I feel like I leave God messages. And he deletes the message before he listens to them. I don't have a problem praying. Sometimes I have a problem wondering if he heard me. But there are reasons why God doesn't answer your prayers immediately. The first reason that I want to note is that sometimes God will not answer your prayers immediately because he wants you to see how it feels when he wants to talk to you, but you're too busy to listen. The Bible says, according to John, the 10th chapter, my sheep hear my voice and another they will not follow. In other words, God is always talking to us, but sometimes we're so busy doing our own things and fulfilling our own agendas that we can't hear the voice of God because we're listening to the voice of people. Men and women should always pray and faint not. And I'm not talking about 911 prayers. I'm not talking about when you're in a car accident and you go before the Lord. I'm not talking about when a diagnosis in your body is destructive. I'm not talking about when there's limitations in your finances and you don't know how you're going to pay a bill. I'm talking about God consistently wants us to not just pray, but be people of prayer. People who have a prayer life.
We're doing the Knoxville Ministry Marriage Initiative right now. And one of the things that Lady Arnold is teaching us is that in marriage, you have to maintenance your marriage. You cannot just talk when storms come up or when chaos hits your covenant or when the enemy attacks your ministry marriage. She's trying to teach us that we have to fortify and we have to build foundation and have some sense of stick-to-itiveness to our marriage, that when we have communication every day, it makes it easier to communicate during difficult times. And so it is with God. We've got to have a prayer life that is consistent and persistent and is not predicated upon the pains that hit us in life. We've got to stop praying and be people of prayer. Second reason I believe that God sometimes doesn't answer our prayers is I believe he doesn't answer our prayers because sometimes he is testing our level of spiritual maturity. You see, every person has to be tested in their level of spiritual maturity. And if the truth be told, you don't know where you are spiritually. Some of you think you have a doctorate degree in spiritual maturity, but you're actually in kindergarten in your spiritual maturity. You see, you don't know it. You don't know where you are in the faith until you're tested. Until you're tested, you see. Many of us think we're delivered of things, but we have not been delivered from the inclination of our sin. We've just been delivered from the atmosphere of it. And we haven't been placed in situations to really know where we are in Christ. And some of you are saying, I never take a drink another day in my life. Well, ain't nobody got on your nerves bad enough yet. Can I get away? I ain't cussed since 1974. Well, let the right person pull out in front of you. Can I get a witness? You don't really know. You don't really know where you are in God until God allows you to go through some temptations and some tests until you get backed into the corner. And so sometimes God does not answer our prayers immediately because he's testing our spiritual maturity. And if you know anything about tests, if you have any inclination of academia or education, you understand that the teacher cannot talk during the tests. Okay. All right. Y'all gonna have to, y'all catch that after the second service or something. Yeah. The teacher can't talk after the test. It is not time to lift up your hands and start asking the teacher questions in the middle of the exam or in the test. No, you got to open up your mouth or lift up your hand while the teacher is instructing you. Oh, y'all not talking to me. You can't be Facebooking and tweeting and Instagramming and Snapchatting and playing tic-tac-toe during service. This is instruction time. And what you don't understand, that if you made it to church today, it ain't just for us to shout and high-five our neighbor. Baby, you in class. And if you're in class today, it's an indication you're going to go through something, that this word, you're going to have to pull it back up and use it. Because when you hit that test, you can't lift up your hand and start asking questions to the teacher. Preach there, Alana. I'm doing the best I can. So that's why I don't want nobody sitting next to me in church trying to show me their baby pictures, talking about how we almost lost the game last. Now, I want to hear nothing about Butch Jones. I want to hear something about Jesus Christ, because I understand that I can't get distracted by devils that's sitting next to me, because they're trying to keep me from getting all this revelation, because sooner or later you're going to need this for the test that you're about to come into. Even if you don't feel like you need it now, hide it in your heart, because you're going to need it later. Why he talking about money? Why he talking about saving? Why he talking about sowing? I got plenty of money. Baby, you got plenty of money now. Why he talking about healing? Why he talking about deliverance? Why he talking about taking care of your body? I'm healthy. I go to the rush. I'm huge. You see these triceps, these biceps? Baby, that's right now. But you one diagnosis from falling apart, by brothers and sisters. I know that by experience. You're one diagnosis from being dead in the next 4 weeks. So that's why you gotta hide the word in your heart. Because sooner or later, you're gonna be tested, and you can't question the teacher during the test. Third thing, and there's plenty more, I just don't have time. Third reason I believe that God doesn't answer our prayers immediately And we see it here in the case of Saul. Saul is trying to get spiritual results by praying a carnal prayer. He's trying to get a revelation from God, yet he is peppered in fear. You see, the only way that we can get God's attention is to walk in faith. The Bible says the only thing that pleases God is our faith. The just shall live. Oh, you know your Bible. So the only thing that can get God's attention is your faith. You don't want to hear this. You don't want to hear this because this show nothing give you a nightmare. But your pain will not pause Jesus to fix your situation. You didn't know that. You think just because you're going through something, just because you're dealing with cancer, just because they found some tumors, just because you lost a loved one, just because you don't have any money, or just because you're going through a season of destruction, that automatically gets God's attention. It does not. The Bible says that Jesus' disciples were on their way across to the other side, and they were in a boat, and the Bible says that as they were about to fall into the water, into destruction, and about to die, the Bible says Jesus came walking on the water. Isn't that awesome? He's walking on the water. Now, here's the part that most of you have just flew back when you read that scripture. The Bible says he looked at them and saw them toiling, saw them struggling in the storm. These are guys that he loved, he slept with, he ate with, he ministered with, he empowered, and he sees them in their storm, and the text says that Jesus sees them, and he was about to pass them by. How can you see me about to drown and go under? Jesus, you have the power to pull me out of this, and you're still about to pass me by. And then Peter looked and said, I think that Jesus, this dude about to pass us by. He said, Jesus, I ain't sure if it's you, but if it is, bid me to come. Come where? Walking on the water. You see, that's a faith comment. And when Peter stepped out of fear into faith, Jesus stopped and said, wait a minute, who is this cat? Got all this faith. Man, let me come by here. Help him out. God is not concerned with what you're going through, but if you would ever open up your mouth and ask God to help you do the impossible and strengthen your faith and come out of fear, God will stop the storms that are coming in your life. I dare somebody in here just to open up your mouth and give God praise for something that he ain't brought you out yet. But your faith says, I might be in it, but my faith is about to pull me out. Y'all not talking to me. I need you to shout for the bill that's already paid. I need you to shout for the tumor that's already dried up. I want you to shout for the marriage that's already mended. I want you to shout for the child that's already at church. I need somebody, anybody, to open up your mouth and give God some praise because you know it's already done. You can't praise him when you get in the Bentley. You got to praise him while you're still on the bus stop. Can I get a witness? Saul says, I don't hear from God. And instead of waiting to hear from God, he goes backwards. He tells his servant, any witches that I might consult? He says, well, the servant says, now there's a witch down in the Endor, but Saul, you said we couldn't talk to no more witches. And Saul said, yeah, but because I ain't hearing from God, I listen to the world. What do you do? And who do you talk to when you ain't been hearing from God? Witches. voodoo, palm readers, horoscopists, mind readers, 1-900 women. Touch somebody, tell them, leave them witches alone. Witches. Well, I don't mess with voodoo dolls. I don't mess with all that crazy stuff. You talking about the occult stuff, man. I don't mess with them bones. I don't mess with them. Well, let me tell you something. A witch doesn't have to be someone with a brew and frogs and a pot and a hat on their head. A witch could be somebody that's in the world that you're trying to get spiritual advice from. So how you telling me how to pull my marriage together? You on your fourth wife. Never mind, I gotta go. We got another service. Y'all don't like me. How you telling me how to stay in the spirit and pull my faith together and you smell more like weed than anybody I ever been around? How you gonna tell me how to increase and produce financial increase in my life when you cheating on your income tax and selling your food stamps? Witches. You cannot give me godly information on how to pull my relationship together when you get all of your information from hip hop wives and housewives of Atlanta. I need a revelation from God on how to live my life. I don't need revelation from empire. Y'all. Touch somebody real softly in a Christian place and tell them, lead them witches along. God says, if you would just wait on the Lord and be of good courage. For they that wait upon the Lord shall renew, and they shall. If you wait on God, he'll take you to high places. Are you listening to me today? He goes to Endor, the place of witches. The king goes to the place of carnality. I've got 7 minutes. The king goes to the place of carnality. But he understands something, Rob. This is what he understands. I can't go as the king to a carnal place because they're going to recognize who I am. So what I'm going to do is put on carnal clothing and try to fit in with carnal people. He had to give up his kingship to hang out with carnality. And the Bible says when he put on his Halloween mask and went down there to Endor, he had to first take off his king's robe, because you cannot put on a carnal mask on top of your kingship. So you got to give up your kingly authority and come down to carnality and ghettoism. And the text says when he gets down there, he fooled the witch for a little while. But then she said, no. We supposed to be down here, but you a king. What she was saying to him is, just because you took off your king's attire don't mean I don't see some God in you. Y'all not talking about, y'all not talking to me. Y'all not talking. You know why you're not talking to me? Because you want us all to believe that you always keep on your kingly Christian attire. You want us to believe that the Sundays you're not here, you at home praying and fasting. When the truth of the matter is, you're recovering from a hangover. Not what happened in Knoxville, but what happened in Hotlanta. Oh, y'all not talking to me. You didn't have your church clothes down there, did you? Nah, you didn't have your tambourine at the club, did you? Nah, but aren't you glad, whoo, Lord have mercy, that even when the enemy lures us back down into Endor, God got his hand so on us that we cannot help but expose the anointing that's on my life. Y'all, I couldn't go back to the club. I couldn't. Boy, I would turn a club out. I could dance. You better ask Malika. I could turn a club. She remember in my slim day. Boy, I was bad. Where Malika? Where you at? Was I bad, Malika? I could turn a club. I'm talking about, man, I fool around and jump in the middle and have people talking about, go slim, go slim, go slim. Man, I try to go back in there. Next thing you know, I'm trying to do the nay-nay and stuff. I've been done got to shouting and speaking in tongues because it's too much on me for me to go back to what he brought me out of. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff. A rod is to beat off the enemies. The staff got a hook on it. It pulls the enemy out of me. Aren't you glad that he got a staff that when you try to go to the club and drop it like it's hot, by the time you get it down, he grab you around your neck and say, if you don't get back to church and start praising God. Tell somebody he protected me from me. When I wanted to go back, he pulled me back to him. When I didn't love him, he kept on loving me. When I was running from him, he was running after me. I gotta go. Y'all don't like me today. Y'all don't like me today. Samuel came back. I don't know how this works theologically. When I want to be a pastor and a preacher of integrity, right? And so I know a whole lot of Bible. I've been studying the same book for a whole lot of years. So I know a whole lot of Bible. But there are some theological tensions that in the scriptures that mess with my systematics and mess with my doctrinal understanding of the scriptures and theological concepts. And this is one of them. Because the text says that while he was dabbling with those spirits, that this woman really brought Samuel back. I don't know how that works. When I know the answers, I tell you, I know the answer. When I don't get it, I don't get it. Somehow, some way, they pulled a seance together. This dude's spirit came out the ground for real. That right there show you better leave these devils alone, because you'll get more than you bargained for. I don't know how that worked. All I know, he started playing with the occult, and then the occult started playing with him. And it's cool to sin when you control it. The problem is, he'll come up and then start trying to control you, and you can't get loose. So y'all can play around this Halloween if you want to, with these witches and these bones and these horror movies. You watch enough of The Shining, blood might come out of your showers. Yeah. You let your kids start walking, watching enough Chucky, your child might turn into Chucky. He is the prince of the powers of the airwaves. That's a whole nother different story there. So I don't know how that worked. All I know is Samuel came up. And Samuel said, because you didn't listen to God. You didn't wait on his answer. Not only am I down here, but by tomorrow, you and your kids gonna be down here too. It's what you call a generational curse. It's bad for you to have to deal with destruction, but it's worse when you set a pattern and example for your family and they follow you into the very piles and pits of hell. So we got to leave them witches alone. Because if you hear from God, if you'll trust him, if you'll wait on him, he'll give you an answer. And this is the last thing I've got to say. What he didn't get is that his fear was unnecessary. Who was he afraid of? Talk to me, family. Say it louder. Y'all smart. Come on. He was afraid of the Philistines. What chapter are we reading? 1 Samuel what? He's afraid of the Philistines in 1 Samuel, the 28th chapter. But in 1 Samuel, the 17th chapter, David killed Goliath, who was a Philistine. So God is insulted that the Philistines have produced fear in the lives of his people when just 11 chapters ago he proved himself to stand up on his people's behalf. My question is, what are you worrying about today that God gave you victory over last year? Y'all not talking to me. Ooh, this is a rough one. Why are you stressed out over here when God already showed you he was going to make you an overcomer over there? This ain't the first time you had money problems. This ain't the first time you had employer problems. This ain't the first time your marriage has been on the brinks. This is not the first time the enemy has attacked your body. This is not the first time that your children have gone cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs. But has not God proven himself time after time after time that he will never leave you nor forsake you, but he will be with you until the ends of the earth? If he did it before, he can do it again. Same God back then. So don't insult him. Don't go to carnality looking for answers that Christ can only give you. And stop resurrecting Samuel. Some things were good for you in that season. You can play because they don't like me. Play a little bit. They were good for you in that season, but that season is over, and God wants it to die. Now you have matured, where you don't have to go through a man to hear the voice of God. You can hear the voice of God for yourself. Tell three people, lead them witches along. Stand with me and give God praise if you receive the word today. Come on, give him praise if you receive. Lift your hands. Let's just worship him as I pray. Come on, worship team. It's on y'all, ain't it? Y'all ain't got to get up here with the hay. Just lift your hands and begin to worship God. All over the world. How many of you received from the word today? Now, let me ask you this. How many of you here know that I wasn't talking to your neighbor? If that's you, just punch and say, somebody, you talking to me, you talking to me. I dare you to look at four people and tell them that was my word. That wasn't your word. Tell them that was my word. You can't have that word. That was my word. That wasn't your word. You see, that's how you know you're in the right place at the right time when you come to a service and you say, man, that was my word. I needed to hear that. The problem is this. You got the word. Now what you gonna do with it? No more fear over your life. That fear is keeping you from writing that book. That fear is keeping you from going back to school. That fear is keeping you from starting that 501c3. That fear is keeping you from getting reconciled back to that loved one that y'all been going at it for years. That fear is keeping you from reconciling that marriage. That fear is keeping you from going to the doctor. That fear is keeping you from starting that business. This is your season, man. This is your moment. This is your time. Why God gotta bless me? He can bless you too. He don't care nothing about your color. He don't care nothing about how you were raised. He don't care nothing about you being fatherless. God loves to use impossible people to do impossible things. Is there anything too hard for God? You ain't gonna find God at the new car dealership. You always gonna find him at the junkyard. Because he gets more glory when he starts with a deficit. And you're a deficit until God puts his hands on you. This is your season. But you cannot allow your fear
to stop you from walking in your faith. This is your season. This is your day. A fresh anointing is coming your way.
Y'all ain't receiving it.
It's a season of power.
Are y'all listening to me, Shauna? You listen to me.
And prosperity. It's a new season.
Bump yourself and say, it's coming to me.
Lift your hand. This is, yeah, come on. Come on, worship team. Give it all you got. Give it all you got.
This is your season.
This is your season.
It's my season. It's my day.
It's a new day. It's a fresh
anointing. Go talk to him for me. Go talk to him for me. Y'all bunched up.
It's
come on, lift your voice a little faster. Come on. Give it to the musicians.
It's a season of power
and prosperity.
Come on.
And prosperity.
Oh, it's a new season.
Come on, drama.
It's a new season.
Coming to me.
Coming to me.
Come on, talk to yourself. Say, this is my season.
I need to hear y'all sing it. Let me hear your testimony. Say, this a new season?
Yes. That's right. You better prophesy to yourself a fresh anointing. Coming my way. Y'all need to be in the choir. It's a season of power. Anybody need some money and prosperity? Come on. This is my season.
This is my season.
It's coming to me.
And it's coming to me.
Grab somebody's hand all over the building. This is your season.
This is your season.
Hold on a second. This is your season. Now, what I love about the fall season is there's three things that happen during the fall season that happens in no other season. Number one, the temperature begins to change. I prophesy that over your life today, that those of you that have been struggling with some hot stuff in your life, I decree and declare that your life is about to cool down. As your man of God, I speak fresh air over your life. You're going to be able to breathe again. The second thing that happens in the fall is the changing of the leaves. Things begin to get brighter. I speak that over this family's life and those that are listening via internet and driving down the street. I decree and declare that this is your season of change. If you've been dealing with poverty, God is changing it to prosperity. If you've been dealing with sickness, God is changing it into health. If you've been dealing with sorrow, God is changing it into joy.
Let me say it this way. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy is coming in the morning. Good morning, family. The third thing that happens, and you ain't gonna like this, is that after the leaves begin to change, they dry up, die, and fall off. I lastly pray this over your life, that every dead thing and dead person that has been attached to you is about to dry up and fall off of you. Every witch that has been flying around your life on a broom, that's been casting spells over your destiny, I decree and declare that they dry up now and die. You're about to feel lighter because this is your season. This is your day. A fresh anointing is coming your way. It's a season of power and prosperity. It's a new season, and it's coming to you. Every head is bowed, every eye is closed. My brother, my sister, you cannot have a new season until you come out of your old. There's no such thing as walking into a new season as long as you're holding on to your old season. And some of you haven't allowed yourself to walk away from your old life and connect to your new life in Christ Jesus. So today, I'm going to give you one of the greatest gifts that a man could give anybody. It is the gift of salvation. It's better than a Mercedes. It's better than a Lexus. It's better than a Maybach. It's better than a jacuzzi. It's better than a trip to Acapulco. This trip is eternal. It's a trip to heaven. Today, if you're not 100% sure that you're saved, but there's that 99% that you're saved, but then there's that small percentage that says, Pastor, I don't know, man. I don't know what would happen to me if I were to die today. I want Jesus. I want to leave this place knowing with 100% surety that if I die, heaven will be my home. I'm leaving the witches alone. And I'm not going to consult the enemy for any more divine answers. I'm going to the divine himself. If you're in this place, you're not 100% sure that you're saved. You want to go to heaven. You don't want to go to hell. You want to live for Jesus. You don't want to live for yourself. Today is the day of salvation. Now is the appointed time. I don't care what you've done wrong last year or last month or last week or last night. God will save you if you want to be saved. You could be a Crip. You could be a Blood. You could be a gangster disciple. You could be a vice lord. You could be in the mafia. You could be a blue-collar criminal. You could be a white-collar criminal. You could be sleeping with someone else that is not your wife today. But God will save you if you want to be saved today. Today he will start you over. Has nothing to do with your lifestyle. It has everything to do with what Jesus has done for us over 2,000 years ago. My brother, my sister, I offer Christ to you. Second group of people, you're saying, Pastor, I'm saved, but I'm without a church home. I need to get in a church home. I need to be connected to a church so that I can get instructions, because when the test comes, I can't ask questions. I want to be in a place where I can receive the word of God and it's clear and precise, that I might be able to use it in a relevant way. I want to join this church. Third group of people, you're saying, Pastor, I'm saved. I've got a church home, but it's in Memphis. My pastor, Stacy Spencer, is in Atlanta. My pastor's Dallas Wilson. It's in Huntsville. My pastor's Troy Garner. It's in Houston. My pastor's Bishop Roger Johnson. It's in Texas, Dallas. My pastor's T.D. Jakes. But I'm going to be in this city for the next year, 2 years, perhaps 3 years. I don't know. But I need somebody to cover me. I need to be under watch care until I go back. If that's you, I want you to respond by squeezing somebody's hand. If you're in any of those three categories, when I count to three, just squeeze that hand, saying, Pastor, you talking to me, man, and I'm making a decision. I don't care who you are today, from the pulpit to the pews. You could be a preacher, you could be an usher, or you could be a layperson. If you're in one of those three categories, I want you to squeeze somebody's hand. Not going to give you the mic, not going to ask you to say anything. I just want you to pray
with me so that you might live the best life that God has for you. When I count to three, I want you to squeeze that hand as though your hand holding the hands of Jesus Christ yourself. One, don't let the enemy keep you bound another day of your life. Two, pride coming before destruction and a haughty heart before a great fall. Three, squeeze that hand right now all over the building. People are squeezing hands right now by faith. My brother, my sister, I offer Christ to you. There were two of you. You're standing to my left, which is to your right. You didn't squeeze anybody's hand, but God is all over you. He's honing you right now. He won't give you peace until you make that decision. I need you to squeeze that hand right now. One, two, three. Squeeze it again as tight as you can. Father, I've done all I can do. No man can come lest he be drawn by you. If somebody squeezed your hand, I want you to lift that hand straight up in the air right now. Right now. Hands are going up all over the building. All over the building. Keep them up. 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 Hey, my shot. Hey. Keep them up, keep them up, keep them up, keep them up, keep them up. Now, everybody that's in this building that has a hand up, I want you to run to this altar right now. Let me pray for you real quickly. Come on. Even if somebody lifted your hand, I want you to bring them to the altar real quick. Come on. This is your season. Come on, 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 come on. Come on, come on, come on, come on. They're coming from the building. The north, the south, the east, and the west. My brothers, my sisters, all over this building, let's make some decisions to follow Jesus.